I guess we're working. This is a madhouse, usually.
So we're looking at the camera now.
All right, guys, welcome to Hamvention 2016. And you're watching, of course, W5KUB.com. And we have our friend astronaut Doug Wheelock with us today. And you've been a busy guy today. There's been a lot of people lined up to see you, man.
I see RJ out there from Harrisburg, Pennsylvania.
You saw him last week.
I just was with RJ. What was that, Tuesday morning over in Harrisburg. And so we've been just kind of making the rounds. Great to see you again, RJ.
Yeah, okay. Well, what we're going to do, we're going to take questions from our chat room. Doug. Who was the girl sitting at the laptop? I don't know if they're talking about my wife or your wife.
Oh, the girl sitting at the laptop. Let me bring her over. Kelly. And is it to look in the camera? Is this the girl you're referring to? This is my beautiful wife, Kelly. So we call her Little Wheels. Very
little
tiny.
That's good.
Little Wheels. They call me Wheels. They call her Little Wheels. Thank you, Kelly. They asked who the beautiful girl at the laptop was.
Yeah, thanks. Okay, so here we go. We're going to start taking questions, man. It's going to be
We're
going to hit you with them, okay?
Let's do it. All right.
All right.
I'll try to be brief. And
all right, here we go. Clear. Here we go. What's your favorite space sci-fi movie of all time?
Gosh, I love 2001, A Space Odyssey. So many good ones. I like parts of Interstellar to that newer one. I really liked Interstellar. Just sort of the psychological parts of that is, from my time as an astronaut. Let's see. Of course, I love Star Trek. I love Star Wars. I'm not real big on the early Star Wars movies, but I saw this latest one and loved it. And now, by the way, on my STS 120 mission, this patch right here on my uniform, we flew it was the 30-year anniversary of the very first Star Wars movie. And so for George Lucas, we flew the very first lightsaber on board the Space Shuttle Discovery.
Cool. So. All right. Well, it looks like Kelly and Kathy have left us, so
they bailed out on us. So.
Okay. What do you see as the future space transport system for NASA? And you're looking forward to this, aren't you?
I'm looking forward to it. Actually, the next couple of years, 2 to 3 years, is going to be very, very exciting down on the Space Coast in Florida. Of course, we haven't been launching shuttles since 2011. We've been going riding to and from space with the Russians. But starting the end of 2017, beginning of 2018, you'll start to see some of our new rockets going from the Space Coast in Florida. And the shuttle, Space Launch System, the SLS, is a huge rocket. Our first launch is scheduled for December of 2018. And we're very, very excited to launch our new Orion exploration vehicle on top of that big rocket and be watching the skies above Florida in 2018 as we send this big rocket back out to the moon and onto Mars.
You know, these new rockets that are going to take you back next time, don't you want them to test them a little bit more? Do you feel like you're testing enough?
I don't think you can ever test enough. We try to test as much as we can, but then we get about our business. But we will have 3 test flights on each of these new rockets that are coming. The first one will be without people. And then we'll put 2 people on it, and then we'll put 2 people on the next one, and we'll do a longer duration mission just to kind of prove out all the life support systems. So we'll be doing 3 major test flights on each vehicle before we start flying long duration missions.
Well, Dave says, as people like you make America great, how many autographs do you sign every year, do you think?
I don't know that, Dave, but thank you very much. Makes America great is just really, I love coming here to the Ham Convention because just great.
Right. Is that feedback?
Just great Americans that we get a chance to meet here. And you know, people are the same all over, very, very proud of their country, very proud of our space program. And so we're just very honored to represent. And I wanted to make sure that everybody out there listening understands that this space station and us, we astronauts, we actually belong to you. So if you pay taxes in, here in the United States, this is your space program. This is your space station. We work for you, and so we want you to be involved and at least let your voice be heard for what we're doing here at NASA.
Yeah, well, look at all the questions. Gee, man, I'm scrolling. What's the best way to know when trying to contact NA1SS? The best way?
There is actually, of course, we're line of sight with the ham radio. The question is about how do you get in touch with the ham radio on board the International Space Station, November Alpha 1 Sierra Sierra. First, I want to say that that the astronauts on board really only have time. They do this on their free time, and so usually it's in the evenings, their evening, which is we operate the space station on Greenwich Mean Time, so Zulu time. So if you figure from 7 to 10 p.m. Zulu, and so you can kind of calculate where you are in relation to GMT and where you are on the which continent you're on, then those would be the best times to catch the crew aboard the space station when the space station's passing over that continent in line of sight, and also during their off-duty times at GMT.
Well, and let me say, it's easy for you to talk to the Earth, because all you have to do is pick the mic up and you're thousands then are yelling at you.
That's exactly right. If you go on to a search engine and look up Doug Wheelock ham radio from the space station, I put together a little YouTube as I was actually making contacts from the space station to try to help you get a feel for what it's like on board the station, because we're line of sight for all these stations. I would just make that call that I'm on the air, and I'd get a barrage of alphanumeric bits and pieces of call signs. So it's very difficult to kind of pick out the call sign. So it's helpful if you maybe give a location at the end of your call sign, say from California or from Memphis or wherever, what have you, or if you have a catchy phrase for the alphanumeric of your call sign as well.
HFN,
Hot Friday Nights. I remember Hotel Foxtrot November. All I heard at the end was Hot Friday Night. So that kind of caught my attention. So I heard Hot Friday Night out there, and everyone else seems to give a little bit of persons to have a clear contact with the station. So.
Well, and you know, from the ground side, and where I was on the ground side, first of all, you got to know when you're coming over. So get you a software program that tells when the space station's coming over, like Doug said, in line of sight. And, you know, they use split frequency, learn which one to transmit on, which one to receive on. And I suggest, people have worked the space station with just a handy talkie, little rubber ducky antenna, but that doesn't put out much signal when you've got thousands of other people competing.
Yes.
So try to get a little handheld Yagi and point it in direction, and you're going to have about a 7, 8, 9 minute pass, and that's going to be about it, because this guy flies fast.
And you can get, there are apps you can get that, I think one is called the Sky Above. It also kind of maps out constellations and everything, and you can, the space station is on there, and you can just kind of point it towards the sky in the daylight, and it'll help you track the station as well. So you could take a look at that as well. There's also a NASA website called Spot the Station. So go to spotthestation.com, and that'll help you know where the station is at all times as well.
Well, this is probably a good question. What's your favorite food in space?
Favorite food in space? Well, space food is... Actually, I brought some with me. I should bring some on camera here. Yeah, you give me a minute. I'll get some space food.
Can we eat it now?
You probably wouldn't want to do that.
No, I wouldn't. Okay. All right. He brought space food, but I can't eat any of it. So, you know. Yeah.
There's a couple of kids watching, too. There's one in the UK.
Okay.
6-year-old.
Okay. All right, good.
Another person, their son, I believe, had a question.
Okay. Oh, boy.
So, I don't know. Tom, it's no Corky's barbecue or anything out of Memphis,
guys, but Freddy,
I don't know if you can zoom the camera in there, but
this looks like something I swept up off my shop.
Yeah, that looks like something you'd maybe feed to the cat or something, but it's It's turkey tetrazzini. And then,
oh, now that looks more like me here.
This looks like
a Salisbury steak or something.
It's kind of like a hamburger. That's a cheeseburger in paradise right there when you have that in space. And so our food,
cheese to put on.
Of course, this is kind of nice. It's M&Ms, and we carry in space as well. So all these different foods. Here's a chicken pineapple salad. And so our food comes dehydrated like this. Or sometimes we have it as military meals. You may see those packets of. It's sort of thermostabilized food. So you can only imagine that when you either put hot or cold water into something like this, it kind of tastes like the plastic that it's wrapped in. So actually my favorite food in space was when they would send up a resupply vehicle. They would usually put in like fresh fruit, like oranges and sometimes some lemons and things like that. And we get those aboard when a supply capsule would come. And that was my favorite food in space, is a fresh apple or a fresh orange.
Is this an entire meal?
So this would be the major part of the entree. So this would be part of a lunch. Yeah. And it's a beef patty. And then you'd probably have a salad with it, maybe this chicken pineapple salad, you'd have that with it. And then maybe a veggie as well. We've got green beans.
What is this?
We've got green beans. This is a hearty breakfast here, Tom. This is oatmeal with raisins and spice.
Oatmeal and raisins.
So oatmeal with raisins and spice, and that looks very tasty, doesn't it?
You know.
So this is actually food that I brought back from space, Tom, that I didn't really want it. I looked at it and said, I'm going to wait till I get back. And so I brought this back from space with me, food that I didn't eat. So.
Oh, this is this looks really. I'm so sorry you had to eat that so long, Doc.
So yeah, I can only imagine why I was so excited to get back to Memphis and have some of that Corky's barbecue.
So yeah, okay. So let's see. So we got an 11-year-old here somewhere. Let me see. Wanted to know how do you become? Let's see. Your old son.
Do you feel different?
How do you become an astronaut?
And do you feel different in space? Well, Isaiah is asking that question. Isaiah, to become an astronaut, first of all, it helps if you're interested in the STEM areas. So it's science, technology, engineering, and math. If you have a love of those areas, if you really like those subjects in school, then you're on your way to becoming an astronaut if that's what you want to become. The next bit of advice that I would give you is always be curious. Be curious and ask lots of questions about the world around you, because part of being an astronaut is being curious and help us to solve problems, to be able to go further out into space and actually be able to live longer in space as well. So find something you love to do in either science, technology, engineering, or math, and then be curious, always ask questions, and then work as hard as you can, and don't be afraid to fail. And then get around people like your teachers or maybe somebody that knows a little bit more about the science that you're trying to study, and they'll help you prepare for those great opportunities in science.
What power used on a ham radio in space? I think you basically just have a mobile rig up there. I don't know if it's a Yaesu or a ICOM or one of those brands.
I'm not really sure the power supply, but we do have just a small, Tom, just like a... Just a small kind of mobile unit.
Yeah, it's a mobile unit.
And it's got, we have two antennas that point out to the side, so it'll be port and starboard. As this space station is flying, it goes out port and starboard, which is great for us because most of our antennas, we communicate with Mission Control in Houston and Mission Control in Moscow through antennas that are on top of the space station, so they bounce off a satellite and then back to the Earth, whereas the ham radio now, since the antennas are coming out to the side, we actually have line of sight to any place on the Earth that we're flying over that's within range of line of sight, which when you're out in space, you have a pretty big oval of line of sight. So,
we've got Alana, she's 6 years old from the UK.
Hi, Alana, from the UK. I just love coming over to the UK. I'm wondering how the weather is there. Have you guys been getting some nice weather, or... Is it cloudy? I love coming over to the UK. I was just over there last summer. I spent most of my time up in Scotland and a little bit of in northern part of England. But got to see the Highlands in Scotland, and it's just beautiful, beautiful countryside.
How's the ISS protected by micrometeors or space debris from hitting it?
So if you've seen the movie Gravity, I mean, that was a bad situation where they had lots of debris that were hitting the space station. And so on the outside of the space station, we have this shielding, and it's covering all of our habitable areas in the space station. And so we have layers of shielding. So hopefully if you have a big or small particle that's coming at you in a crossing orbit, first of all, you hope it's not like directly opposite, because that'd be a pretty high velocity, and it probably would actually run the danger of puncturing the hull. So if you get a glancing blow, we actually have the shielding where it can bounce off or maybe even penetrate one layer, but not the next layer. So we have some good protection on the space station.
So do you ever have any leaks?
You can have leaks. We didn't have any when I was there. But we're always looking out for leaks on the space station as well. And actually, our best leak detection meter
is our
ears. Yeah. That's right. You could feel your ears popping with just maybe sometimes when you go up in altitude, like in an elevator or something like that, or even down at the bottom of a pool, when you're swimming to the bottom of the pool, you can feel the change in pressure in your ears. So your ears can really sense that change in pressure before even our instrumentation on board the space station.
You know, I would think there's always a chance that something can hit that space station up there. You know, in an airplane, if we depressurize, we have oxygen masks could fall. Do you have any type thing that protects you if the space station depressurizes quickly?
Well, we have oxygen masks on board as well. But at the end of each module, so the space station is built in modules, they're kind of hooked together. And in the front and back, or forward and aft part of those modules, there's a hatch, a big metal hatch that you can close. And then you can close the other ones on the other side as well. So we call that isolation. You can isolate a module, like if one of the modules gets hit by a piece of old rocket debris or even a meteor or something like that, and it tears a hole in the hull, we could actually feel that, and we could see the air rushing out and hear the air rushing out of that module. We can actually close that module off and save the rest of the station. So there is a way that we can isolate a module if it has a hole in it. So,
talking about is ham radio on the IS vital for emergency communications?
Absolutely, we do have. That's the primary reason the ham radio's on the space station. Secondary reason is to have fun and make contacts all over the world, which I tried to do when I was up there in 2010. And so we made hundreds of contacts up there. In fact, I sort of met Tom while I was in space and he was on the ground. We connected on the ham radio. And so, but the ham radio is on board. In case the space station starts tumbling, if you remember earlier, I said our antennas are on top of the space station, and that's how we bounce off a satellite. If we start tumbling out of control because of some sort of failure on the space station, we can't point our antennas towards those satellites. So the first place we head to is the ham radio, and we have emergency contact stations across every continent, really, that's got people on it. There are operators there on every continent that have agreed to be an emergency contact person or station for NASA. So they'll relay relay signals to and from NASA to the space station.
Well, we actually have a hot Friday night on here watching.
Hot Friday night. How are you doing there,
sir? He's back in Memphis. He said hello to you.
Missing you here in
the barbecue capital.
The barbecue capital of the world.
And Doug was in Memphis a couple weeks ago, and we had a little gathering there, and we went and had Corky's barbecue.
It was nice. It was nice because Corky's barbecue out of Memphis was my first meal back on the planet, and I hadn't had anything like that in 6 or 8 months, and so it was quite tasty.
Well, you know, when I sent that down, I mean, everybody kept saying, they're not going to let you eat that. I mean, and also I understand that they just don't take food and packages from anybody because somebody could poison you.
Yeah, that's right.
Do you have tasters, or how do they get through?
So I think when I showed up I landed underneath a parachute in Kazakhstan, so we kind of did our soft landing over in the Kazakh steppe, and then about 24 hours later, we're landing in Houston, and so I went right into quarantine there, post-flight quarantine. They do a lot of medical checks and things on you, And as soon as I got done with all those medical checks and they drew blood again and kind of looked at my bone structure and my muscle strength and everything, then I was able to have my first meal of earthly food. And so they said, right over here, we've got special in from, it came via FedEx. I figured they probably trusted the sender.
All right, that's good. Well, you know, I'm worried. I was worried they were going to let you even eat it. I mean, after eating this, after eating this for six months, yeah. And then you get barbecue. I don't know how that works on your system.
You have to go really slow with the barbecue, even though it's like really, really fine, barbecue from Memphis or wherever, you know, there's some folks all over, like Carolina barbecue or Texas barbecue, something like that. You just have to go really slow when you get back to Earth because our stomach is not used to the spiciness and the flavor. So,
do you know any rumors about deorbiting the IIS in 10 years?
I don't know of any rumors about the deorbiting the ISS. We hope to keep the ISS going as long as possible. Right now, I think we've got a full extension to 2024, and I know that there's some commercial interest to continue with that in years beyond. And so as long as we can keep it flying, which, you know, it's a harsh environment out there as well. So a lot of these things are breaking down. It really tests what we know about. These things have to, especially the things on the outside of the space station, are operating in vacuum, which is very hostile as well to machinery and things like that, and valves and things. And also the temperature, there's wild temperature swings. We're orbiting the Earth once every 90 minutes. So every 45 minutes, we're either getting a sunrise or a sunset. And in direct sunlight, it could be 300 degrees Fahrenheit. And in shadow, 45 minutes later, it could be 300 degrees below zero. So think about how robust this hardware has to be built to be able to withstand 500 to 600 degrees of temperature change within 45 minutes. So the space station's working overtime to stay, and we're working overtime on board to continue to maintain the station as long as we can.
And it's pretty big. I hate for it to fall.
It's big.
Yeah, we need
it's
to keep
big.
It up.
Yeah,
here.
We certainly, if it's going to be brought back, we would certainly get everything off of it that we want and try to bring it back home in the way of science and things. And then certainly it would be a controlled descent, so we'd bring it down over the Pacific probably. So
I'm back to this food. Is this like an MRE? I don't know what it's, you know, I was in the military earlier.
Yeah.
We had C rations. That was before your time, probably.
Did we get them out of the cans, little cans?
Yeah, a little P-38.
I remember having those, a little P-38.
Tom,
you know why they call that for all the folks there in the military that have that can opener? You know why they called it a
P-38? I know why.
Why do you remember?
Well, I think I know why. I think it takes 38 times to go around
there
the can,
you go.
Right?
To open to go around one of those cans in a C ration.
That's right.
It takes 39 kind of cuts with that P-38.
That's right. So, wow. You remember those.
I do.
I thought that was before your time, man.
I was going to say.
Doug, you spent how many years in the Army?
30 years.
30 years,
4 months, and 12 days in the Army.
All right, and you retired.
I retired on October 1st, 2012.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, right before you retired, you went over to the Middle East, Afghanistan?
I went over to Iraq. Did some work in Afghanistan. I flew out of Kandahar, so anybody watching out there that, first of all, a little shout out to our men and women in the service, and those who are maybe family members of service members that are even folks that are over there now, thank you for your service. And also to our veterans, thank you for your service as well. And we so appreciate you, and love what you've done for us and for our country and for our freedoms. And so thank you for your service. And I got a chance to serve three back-to-back tours in 2011 and 2012 over in Kandahar. So to all my folks that have served in Kandahar, if you remember the Poo Pond over there in Kandahar Airfield, and the folks out there that have been to Kandahar will know that I'm talking about. So greetings and thank you for your service.
Now, you actually flew for NASA while we were over there, right?
I did fly
for
NASA.
You would not even think NASA would be flying in over
That's
there.
Right. That's right. We had WB-57 over there.
Is that a plane?
It's a plane. It's an airplane that we did some reconnaissance work over there. So
WB-57, I've never heard of that one. It's pretty secret, I guess.
That's good. That's good that you
How many planes do they have? A WB-57.
There are two of them. Yeah.
Two in a world.
Yeah.
Wow. Hopefully they have some spare parts out there.
Yeah.
Cool. Okay. Let's see. Here's a retired Air Force guy. Wants to know when we're going to start building shuttles again.
Well, we probably won't build the space shuttle again. The space shuttle is very, very heavy and it could just barely get to the space station. But it essentially helped us bring all the parts up to build that magnificent castle in the sky. And so we won't be building a shuttle again, but we are building an Orion exploration vehicle. We actually are on the second capsule now that we're building. The next mission on Orion is December of 2018. We're gonna kick this capsule out. It's gonna be a huge rocket, much bigger than the Saturn V. We're gonna launch in December of 18. We're gonna essentially refly the Apollo 8 route around the moon, only this is gonna be in a higher lunar orbit. So we're gonna go out further than we've ever been, and we're gonna take this capsule out there with us. We're gonna bring it back, burn it back in through the atmosphere, get landed under parachutes. We're gonna take a look at our rocket, take a look at the vehicle, fix and tweak whatever we need to, and then the second mission, gonna be people on it, and we're gonna go back to the moon. So
that's cool.
So hopefully that'll be in 2020, and so it won't be a shuttle per se, it won't look like the space shuttle with wings, but we're gonna be sending an exploration vehicle, which looks like a big Apollo capsule, back out to the moon and on to Mars.
You know, is it the SpaceX now that's landing actually on barges?
SpaceX is landing their first stage rocket onto a barge. You probably have seen that happen a couple of times. And also there's another company called Blue Origin that's also landing and returning a first stage rocket back to land on Earth as well. So, which is great. You think about it, and especially for our commercial venture, to be able to return and reuse a first stage rocket is a huge cost saving. So.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. How much special protection do you have while up in space if a CME happens?
What's a CME?
CME. Critical medical emergency. I don't know.
Oh, maybe.
I don't know. I'm
not sure what a CME is, but special protection do we have? Coronal mass ejection. So solar radiation. We do have our sleep stations. Our sleep stations are lined it's actually lead bricks that kind of protect us, similar to what we have in an x-ray machine or when you have x-rays. They're actually lined with those things, so there's increased radiation protection inside of our sleep stations, where we spend, you know, a third of our day, you know, 8 hours spent sleeping or in your little crew compartment, so we do have radiation shielding there. And so if we do have a CME event, and we have the solar radiation coming at us, we can actually we actually have our astronauts go into their crew quarters for safe haven as the pulse passes the Earth.
So I learned what that is now.
Yes.
The CME.
Yeah, coronal mass.
You should know that. You're an astronaut.
I should know that.
You should know that. You know what some people may not know, when I was talking to Doug a couple weeks ago, you know, every mission up on the IIS, someone is assigned as the medical person.
That's right. That's right.
You know, in case there's an emergency. And I think you were assigned last time as the medical person.
Yes. So,
right?
So we do have a lot of MDs, medical doctors, that work for NASA and our astronauts. And so if we have one of those folks launching on the station, that's great. They're the chief medical officer of the of that crew. If we don't have a medical officer on board, they select one of the crew members to be the medical officer. So they send us to level one trauma training, and they give us baseline procedures of how to do suturing, how to do a catheter, how to draw blood, how to fix wounds and lacerations and things, and so how to remove an appendix. So so when I was trained to be the chief medical officer on board, we call that the CMO, a little bit different than the CME, but the CMO on board, and I told my crew, of course, I had all of like 3 or 4 weeks of medical training, so I said, hey, I'm your doctor, so make sure you don't get sick on board. So
and so So Doug, you're almost a doctor, my understanding. They sent you before your mission to the emergency room, and you treated people, right? You learned to sew people up and take appendix out. I did,
and it's kind of a scary thought, so that's the limit of my medical training.
It was only
to get us through, enough to fix somebody to get back home safely.
So you told me they brought one guy in, maybe a car wreck. His nose was split in half, half the nose this side and half the nose on this side, and you put it back together for the guy?
He had some lacerations. It was a bad car wreck that we saw that night, and he wanted me to sew his nose up, but I said, I'm going to leave that for the surgeon that actually works in plastic surgery. So he had a laceration on his leg, so I worked on that one as well. So.
But they showed you how to take an appendix out.
They did. I didn't actually do the procedure, but they showed me how to do it. I actually watched it done in the operating room.
So unless it's just a terrible emergency, you would probably put somebody on one of the return capsules or something and send them back.
Yes, on board the space station, we do have two capsules, Soyuz capsules, that are used for emergency evacuation in case we have to quickly get back to Earth. And so we have two capsules on board to do that. And we wouldn't just send one person back. We'd send that whole crew back. And so we only have two Soyuz capsules. Each one has three seats, and we have six people on board the station. So if we send one person home, we'd send that whole crew home. And then at least so we have enough seats on the lifeboat.
So you'd send everybody home?
Well, we'd send that whole crew home, which is one half of the space station crew.
Okay, because there's like the double.
There are two Soyuzes up there.
Yeah, okay.
And two actually separate crews of three that make one big crew of six.
Okay. How often do you have to correct the ISS orbit?
It's probably
ongoing?
about we do reboosting, and we actually adjust the orbit as well. About every 45 days, every 60 days, something like that. We reboost the station, kind of raise the altitude a little bit. So
I guess on some of your resupply missions, they have to bring you fuel or anything?
Yes,
like
they
that?
Do bring fuel. We have fuel on board the space station where we could fire thrusters to raise the orbit. And when we have these resupply vehicles, they bring clothing and food and science and things, but they also bring tanks of oxygen and tanks of fuel on board as well, so we can pump that into and refill the space station.
You know, I guess in weightlessness up here, it doesn't require much boost to move you, I guess.
It doesn't.
I've got an idea for NASA. I might patent this, but I'm going to go ahead and share it right here. Why don't they cut holes in the thing and mount tubes in here, that you could blow in and put a check valve, see? If you want to move the spaceship that way, you just kind of blow out the hole, see? And that kind of moves you over. It might take a couple people.
There's an idea. I'll take that back
to
NASA and see if we can work that into the mix down there.
So how quick could you get back in a dire emergency?
If you needed to get back right away and you didn't care where you landed on the planet, you could undock from the station and land on the planet within about 45 minutes or probably an hour, but take at least the time to undock from the station. Normally, when we come home on a normal, we actually do two full orbits of the Earth as we're phasing for our landing area, and then we target our landing area, and then on the third orbit, and we figure 90 minutes in orbit, so that's 3 hours right there, just getting phased up with your landing area, and then we fire the deorbit engines. It's another 45 minutes to an hour, and we're landing back on Earth.
So it's five to six hours.
Yeah,
a dire emergency. You don't clear it here where you're landing. You may land in the Pacific, the Atlantic.
That's right. If you just
South Pole, North Pole.
Well, we don't go. Our inclination is not down to the poles.
Okay.
We're in a 51.6 degree inclination to the equator. So it could be anywhere in that band between 51.6 degrees north latitude and 51.6 degrees south latitude. And of course, a lot of that is ocean. So if you just undock from the station, fire a deorbit engine and start falling through the Earth, chances are you're probably going to land in the ocean somewhere.
Is ham radio operator completely voluntary for astronauts?
Yes, it is. It is.
You got your license, right?
I got my license just before I went up, and so I I actually didn't realize the fun it could be making contacts around the world. They asked me, do you want to get your ham license? And there's a ham radio on board that we use for emergency situations, communication if we need it. And I said, well, I'm going to be the commander, so I probably should do that. So I took my training and testing, got my technician license, and then went aboard the space station and made hundreds of contacts around the world. And I actually wasn't expecting that, but I thought, well, and it became a great pastime for me in my off-duty time to make contacts around the world.
Okay, have you recruited other astronauts to get their license?
I haven't recruited any, but I have encouraged our new guys coming through, and they're just now going to the space station. I've encouraged them that it's a good thing to do, and it's actually kind of fun once they get on board as well. A lot of folks are like, well, I really don't want to take on more training because your schedule's really pretty full, especially close to launch, and but I've encouraged them. It's like, hey, it's well worth the invested time because the return you get is really lifelong friends and just hundreds of contacts you can make around the globe.
There's a question from Matt about what do you see as the future of SpaceX or other viable commercial space flight? Who else is there besides SpaceX?
Well, SpaceX and Boeing have the contracts now to carry people to and from the station. But we also have other commercial companies. Orbital ATK is launching resupply capsules to the space station. We also have other commercial ventures that are coming along, the Sierra Nevada Corporation, Blue Origin, and several others that are vying for to take cargo to and from, and maybe eventually people to and from space as well. And so I think it's great. It's actually, it helps us as an agency at NASA to be able to kind of focus about going deeper in places we haven't been yet, or maybe even returning to the moon and turning over the commercial servicing of the space station with both people and supplies to commercial enterprise, I think is really a great way to go. We did the very same thing with aviation back in the early days of aviation. Of course, it was the government that sort of had the airwaves, but then now we look at commercial aviation as essentially kind of rules the day for our aviation around the globe.
How long is your work day? I know you use universal time or Greenwich Mean Time.
Yeah, in space we try to keep a regular work day like 9 hours, but about 6.5 of that is actual science and work and things like that. And built in there is 30 minutes for lunch, 30 minutes, and your breakfast starts, of course, the beginning of your day, and your dinner's at the end. But we also build in 2.5 hours of exercise in that 9-hour day. So we usually get 6.5 hours of science, 2.5 hours of exercise to build about a 9-hour work day in space. And we operate the station on GMT, like I mentioned earlier, Zulu time for you aviators out there. And we get the crew up at 6 o'clock a.m. Greenwich, and they go to bed at 9:30 Greenwich. So, 9:30 p.m.
Is there a seat in the space station? You know, I watch the Enterprise. You know, they're sitting there and they have the controls. They're looking out the window. I mean,
you actually don't need a seat. I mean, everything is floating around, and so you don't ever feel like your feet are worn out because you're not walking anywhere. You're floating everywhere. So there are. In fact, when you get into position where you're maybe taking pictures out the window or even talking on the ham radio. I think on that website, if you found it on the YouTube, just look on YouTube and you could see put in there Doug Wheelock ham radio aboard the International Space Station, and you'll see how we can kind of float around, but usually I would lock my feet underneath a foot restraint on the floor and I'd write on a kneeboard.
Doug, I talked about doing this. We've been so busy, I forgot to do it, but I wanted you to send out a tweet.
Okay.
to your, you've got a lot of followers. Okay. I just wanted to see if they could break the chat room, you know?
Okay.
So maybe in a minute you send out a tweet.
In a couple minutes I'll send out a tweet if you'd like to
tell people where they can follow you.
If you'd like to follow me on Twitter, it's @astro_wheels. My last name is Wheelock, so I wish I had Wheels call sign because I had a really cool car or something, but truth is it's my last name, so @astro_wheels, and I'll send a tweet out there and we'll get the ball rolling and see if we can get some a little bit of chatter going on
all right.
that on Twitter as well.
Can you relate to anything that you have seen or heard in space that you could not figure out? Anything weird going on at
Not really. I suppose we do have a VHF radio on board in the Russian segment, and occasionally it'd be kind of cool. We'd be in the Russian segment, which is the, sort of the aft half of the space station as it flies, and we would hear sometimes airliners on the surface, you know, just flying above the surface of the Earth. We'd hear airliners sometimes over VHF frequencies. Yeah. So that was kind of cool.
Yeah.
And other than that, I never really heard anything strange. Sometimes you'll hear if you get into a real quiet module, especially one where there's a hatch, a metal hatch, so like the airlock on board the space station, you could put your ear to the hull and you could hear like sort of like oil canning, like that when with temperature changes because in direct sunlight, it's 300 degrees, then it gets in the shadow and it's 300 degrees below zero, so you can sometimes hear this oil canning in the metal, and that's kind of an eerie feeling.
You hear squeaks kind of different.
Not really.
You know, not squeaks.
Squeaks,
or,
but some straining sometimes in the metal as well.
Yeah.
You put your ear right to the hull, and you can hear that. So. Yeah, like an old can.
Oh, I get you.
Like in Wizard of Oz with the Tin Man when they oiled up his joints.
Have you seen anything strange from up here?
I never saw anything strange. I looked, actually, but you do see some. The Earth at night is like this light show. I mean, it's crazy. The aurora at the poles is like, it looks like the Earth is on fire. It's pretty amazing. And then we also see, when I was outside on a spacewalk one time, I looked down and there's a shooting star, just a meteor coming through the atmosphere below me. So to see a shooting star going below your feet when you're out on a spacewalk is a little bit alarming too. So
we've got Phil said hello from Portugal.
Hi, Phil. I had a good friend on the ham radio from Lisbon, Portugal. I don't know if he's listening in, but sang happy birthday to him back in 2010. I don't know if he's online there, but if you're the one that I sang happy birthday to and you're listening in, join us.
So I wonder if you attend any other ham conventions like Atlanta in the future.
I would love to. I haven't been to others. Like I said, I met Tom, made contact with Tom, actually several, how many times, Tom? 20 some times. When I was on board the space station, almost 30 times.
30 times, yeah.
In the 6 months I was up there. So I connected with Tom and been able to come with him to the convention here in Dayton. This is my third time, I believe, now. Third or fourth time. here in Dayton. And would love to come to other ham radio conventions and send me a note or send a note to Tom, and we'll see if we can link up as well.
You know, and one of the things, I'd love to get you to the Huntsville Ham Fest. Of course, you're not going to be in the States. Huntsville Ham Fest is in August.
Okay.
But in Huntsville, you got the Space Center there, and you could find something to do at the Space Center. Do you ever go there or have any training or anything?
I've been to Huntsville quite often. They do a lot of our payloads there. Mm-hmm. In fact, we have a payload operations center there, kind of like a mission control that's there for our payloads. And so I would love to come to the ham radio convention in Huntsville.
That would be cool. It's a very nice venue there. We're going to have to get you there. I know you're going to be in Russia.
This August, I'm going to be in Russia.
You're going to be in Russia.
I leave on Tuesday, actually, for Star City, and we'll be over there for about 6 months or so.
So one of the things I've talked to Doug about, and we're going to see if he can come through on his promise, is that we're going to have him on one of our Tuesday night shows, one of our live Tuesday night amateur radio roundtable shows. And We're going to bring him in from Russia, and I think that'll be a first. That'll be kind of cool to bring you in. It's going
to
be 4 o'clock in the morning your time.
Yeah, so it's...
You have your hair combed.
I have my hair, my teeth brushed, and if my hair is all messy and I'm on with you, just forgive me for that, all right? So I'll be just waking up.
Well, how large is the ISS?
The ISS is about just an American football field, so which is 100 yards long, and then the end zones are another 10 yards, I believe. So if you were to lay the space station on the football field, it would take up the entire length of the football field, including the end zones, and would kind of spill over a couple feet on either end. And then it's actually wider than a football field. It'd probably go to the stands on all four sides of an American football field or pitch. So it's pretty big.
It's maybe living space, a couple thousand feet.
Living space is kind of like we liken it to about 2,800 square foot home, about that much livable space. And if you think about it, though, we also can use the ceiling and the walls, everything. So you have a lot of
extra surface space.
Like you walk into a room like this or some small room and you say, like, I'm going to be camping here with six people for 6 months. We only look down, it's like, okay, we don't really have enough room on the floor, but if we could sleep on the ceiling, then it really, the space seems much more spacious.
Now, you guys have to be trained to do just about everything up here, anything comes up. So you were involved in some of the big solar panel issues here a few years ago, I think, mm-hmm. some power outages or something.
Back in 2007, I launched on a space shuttle Discovery. And we took the Node 2 Harmony module to the space station. It was going to open up the pathway, the gateway to our European space module laboratory and our Japanese laboratory that are now connected to the Node 2. And when we did that, we also had a big tower on the backbone of the space station. And we took that tower and its solar arrays, and we took it out to the far port wing of the very end of the space station on the left side, the port wing. And we attached it there, and then we unfurled those solar arrays that got caught up. I don't know if you remember this, but this would have been back in October of 2007. And that array tore, and we had to go back out. We had to build sutures and go outside on a spacewalk and sew that solar array up. So that was an interesting spacewalk for sure. It took us nearly 8 hours.
So, Doug, are you familiar with the detail of, like, the wiring or the voltage? Usually the solar panels are low voltage, but then again, they may have the stuff series, and you may have high voltage. Do you know what type voltage levels you have?
It was DC voltage. It was 160 volts, but the amperage coming down the current
really
was
high.
200 in excess of 200 amps. And so when you have that amount of current... We were really leery about operating in the vicinity of that power strip that comes down the side of the arrays, carrying that much current with metal tools. And so we insulated all of our metal tools with tape to kind of keep from getting some sort of arc or anything to the metal parts of our spacesuit or to our tools.
Are all your tools tethered to you somehow?
They are. We do have to. Now you can float. It's kind of cool in space. You can float your tools in front of you, but each one of them has a little hook with a little tether, and you can operate a wrench or even a needle nose pliers or something like that. And when you're done with it, you could just let it kind of float there, and it'll just float on its own tether.
It's tethered. You don't want to lose it out there.
Tethered.
Right?
You don't want to lose it.
You don't want to come around the next orbit and have it poke through the side of the.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. So if it gets away from you, you can impact on the next orbit. That's right.
Doug, I look at these pictures of all the space junk. You know, the government or somebody tracks all the space junk.
Yes.
Radar or something.
That's right.
There's a lot of it up there, man.
I don't know
if it's at a different altitude than where you guys normally are in orbit or...
There is a lot of space junk. And when we look at it sort of in the pictures that we see kind of cartoon-wise, there's a lot of bits and pieces up there, but... When you get up there and you can see how big the Earth is really in relation to our orbit that we're in, I never saw any space junk. And when I was up there for 6 months, we never We never were impacted by any space debris or anything like that.
You never had an old fender float by. No
fender,
or nothing like that.
Like an old 57 Chevy or something like that by. But we do have to worry about it. And of course, NORAD tracks that stuff for us. Anything bigger than, I think it's maybe anything bigger than this piece of hamburger here in this bag, they can see it and they can track it. And they, if we have a conjunction, it looks like we're going to hit something. We can change the attitude of the space station. We can raise our altitude to kind of get out of the way of that conjunction.
You made a number of spacewalks and some very long spacewalks.
Yeah, so I...
Who holds the record for the most spacewalk?
I don't, but I have been outside six times.
Yeah.
I'm getting close, and for the U.S., our lead spacewalker has 10 spacewalks. I have six, and so I'm thinking if I could get a chance to go back again, I'm going to do everything I can to get four more, or at least maybe five more.
Do you have to ask permission to go outside?
Yeah, have to. You can't just throw your suit on, open the hatch, and go outside. It's first of all, it's very dangerous. It costs money because we're using consumables, of course, in the suit.
Yeah.
And every time we open that hatch and go outside, it's very, very dangerous. And so we don't go outside unless we absolutely have to repair something.
So when you're out there, is there any sense of moving fast or falling?
Some people have said that they do get a sense of falling because you come outside and you look down and the Earth is, 250 miles below you. So it's kind of a little bit unnerving. It's a very, very different environment. And we're orbiting the Earth pretty fast, but when you look down, it just looks like the Earth's kind of turning here below you. So the only sensation of speed that we get is with the aurora or maybe lightning strikes. You can see the speed of like lightning on the planet, things like that. Now, you do get a sense of speed when you get inside your capsule and you come home, or inside the space shuttle and you come home, and you turn your engines in the direction of travel, you fire your deorbit burn, you look out the window, and you see the Earth getting really big pretty quickly. So then you can really have that sensation of speed.
What is what's your entertainment? What's an astronaut do for entertainment after your 9-hour day?
Well, actually, I love to talk on the ham radio. So yeah. I got on the ham radio, made lots of friends all over the world, hundreds of friends on every continent.
You got any? Xbox or Nintendo or
no,
TV? Music,
no, but we do have lots of laptop computers with. We have DVD drives that we had a big album, a couple of these albums with sleeves in it, with all kinds of movies. We had, I think we had over 600 movies on DVD. And then if there's something that we wanted to see that was a new release or something, we could ask the ground if they could get that for us. We'd go to bed one night, they'd uplink it to the space station. By the time we woke up in the morning, it was downloaded onto our machines and we could. Every Friday night we tried, when I was up there, you talk about hot Friday nights, I don't know if he's still listening, but from Memphis, but every Friday night we'd have his movie night on board the space station.
Friday night movie night,
so
huh?
So we didn't have any popcorn on board, but we'd do our best with the little tortillas and spread some peanut butter on there or something, and we'd have movie night and watch a movie.
Do they outlaw popcorn?
Yeah, popcorn's a little messy on board the station. It's we tried, because everything's floating, and think about it, if you opened a bag of popcorn, all that would go flying all over the place. So we try to take things that have very little crumbs up there for us. So we don't take any bread. We just take flour tortillas, and we make sandwiches using flour tortillas because they have a lot less crumbs coming off of a tortilla than we do off of a piece of bread or something.
Now, I heard through the grapevine that one mission, when you were doing your experiments, the toilet stopped up.
Yeah.
And you were asked to work on the toilet.
Yes.
So, somebody take over your experiment.
Yeah, so we have two toilets on board.
You have
potty.
A men and a women? Or?
We call it the space potty. Nope, we don't have a men and a women.
Okay.
We just have one on the U.S. segment and one in the Russian segment. And we have six people on board. And so we usually, the three people from the U.S., and our international partners, we use the one, and then the Russians, we use the other. But sometimes it breaks. And one day, I remember I was on board for maybe 2 weeks, and I was trying to work through a science experiment. And I was on board with two very, very smart ladies, PhD scientists, and I was kind of, you know, I'm a test pilot and an engineer, so I was trying to work my way through the science, and one of the ladies came to me. She said, "Hey, the bathroom's broken, the potty's broken." I said, "Well, I can fix the potty." And she said, "If you fix the potty, I'll do your science for you." And I said, like, that's a deal. And so I went back and opened the panels and did a little dumpster diving back there behind the potty and got it fixed. It took me about an hour. But I figured out, if you're on a spaceship and you can fix the potty, you're like king of the universe.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, you know, I'm a big watcher of Big Bang and Warowitz or whatever. He's the inventor of the
space potty, I think. Yeah, I recall that.
Yeah.
He was called Fruit Loops, I think, wasn't he?
His call sign
was Fruit Loops, I believe.
Yeah, he wanted to be Rocket Man, but they gave him a different name there. Yeah.
Yeah.
It says, are you tethered during spacewalks? I would imagine so.
Yes, yes. But it's a tether that you have to put on and take off.
But do you always keep one on at all times?
You try to. We have a safety tether that, but again, it's up to you to hook up your safety tether properly. So you try to keep tethered at all times on when you're outside, especially. You don't want to go flying away. We do have a small jet pack that if you go tumbling off the space station and your tether breaks or something, you can deploy this hand controller, and your backpack has, I think it's 32 jets that fire. You can fly yourself back, sort of like George Clooney in Gravity. But
so that's on you when you're out there, in case.
That's on you, but it's for emergency
yeah.
only. So
well, that's
emergency
that's
use
cool.
only.
How often do you talk to your family on Earth? Do you have a good connection?
So we have a very good connection. We actually have an IP phone on board where we can put a headset on and call anywhere on Earth. And the phone patch is relayed through a satellite and then through Houston. So if you get a phone call from somebody on board the International Space Station, I'm often asked, what's the area code of space? And it's 281, because that's the area code of Mission Control in Houston.
Okay.
So all those calls are routed through 281 area code.
This brings me up to another thought. You know, I'm always working angles with you. We're always trying to do a first on our show. A few months ago, we had a de-expedition down at Heard Island, down in sub-Antarctica,
yes.
And we brought them in live on our show. We're going to bring you in live from Russia on our show. Surely you have some contacts back with NASA, you know. I mean, you're a high-up guy, aren't you? Pretty high up.
Well,
here's what I want to do.
I'm a legend in my own mind.
I want to see if you can pull this off. I would love to bring an interview in to our Tuesday night show live from the space station.
From the space station?
Yeah.
So they're on Greenwich, so if it's 8 p.m.
But it'd be like you would do a satellite call to your family. Can't you do it anywhere you are? You don't have to do it.
I can promise you this, that I will, when I get back to the space station, I promise you that I'll make every attempt to get on tie-in live from the
space
station.
All right, and we'll have you on a show from the space station.
So
I can't wait.
I
can't wait.
That would be great.
Can you go up next month or not? But you have a connection. I mean, you know, when we talk to you on the radio, it's only like a 9-minute connection on the past, but in your telephone or your video, isn't it satellite and you can?
So we could talk through the satellite. So sometimes we'll have, it may be close to an hour connection, and it's pretty good. We'll switch from one satellite to another.
And would that be sometimes video, like Skype or something?
Sometimes we could do video. So for you radio in the frequency band experts out there, so most of our video is carried down over KU band.
Yeah.
We also have KA band. That's going up. Actually, I think it's up there now on the station. It wasn't there when I was there in 2010, but we have KU band, KA band, and our voice is usually, and our commanding is usually carried over S band.
All right, so we're going to plan a live video on our Tuesday night show.
Perfect.
When you get up here.
Perfect.
Someone asked, do you ever try a cell phone from space? I doubt you. They let you carry that up, right?
They don't let us carry up our cell phones, and so I never tried, but
that would be a stretch. But
I mean, I was. It was about 2 months before I launched in 2010, NASA came to me and said, hey, there's this new thing. It's been out for a couple of years. It's called Twitter. And we were wondering if you would send tweets from outer space. And I said, I don't even know what that means. Now, this is back in March of 2010. They said, well, you just let me show you. You just type in 140 characters. You can attach a picture or something, you know, and send it out. And I thought, I don't know if I really want to do that. I didn't really know the power of social media at the time. And then I got a little bit, about 2 weeks down the road, NASA headquarters in Washington called me and they said, hey, we strongly encourage you to open a Twitter account. So if you've ever worked for the government, or like I do with NASA, or in the military, and they strongly encourage you to do something. So it was about 2 days later, I had my own Twitter account. And I started tweeting from outer space.
That's cool. Okay, we have a question we keep missing. They want to know, you know, like if you're trying to turn a big bolt or a nut, you know, with a wrench, you know, how much difficulty you have trying to do something like that? And I would imagine you have to lock your feet around something or hold on.
Yeah, you
do.
You have to remember that there's when you get to space, everything is weightless, so everything's floating around. But when you apply a force, F equals ma, force equals mass times acceleration. So Newton was very, very smart, and that force motion equation, those apply in space as well. So whenever you apply a force in one direction, your body's going to react the opposite. So you have to kind of hold on to something and kind of to torque something
use
down,
your
or
muscles and
maybe lock your
it
feet,
in there. Yeah.
Lock your feet in somewhere as well. So you have to counteract that torque.
Oh, here's a great one. We need to ask this: are there roaches in space? They seem to be everywhere. You have any
I
bugs
think I
up here?
Found the one place. Now I live in Houston, Texas, so I know about roaches, but I never saw one aboard the space station. So we never had any stowaways that I know of. So
yeah.
But they probably do well. It'd be interesting to see how a roach would live in the. Maybe we could do a little science experiment on
there. Maybe slip some up here next time. You know.
I probably have to ask NASA first.
I was talking about taking a cell phone up. I mean, I'm sure that every ounce of weight is calculated for these launches, and two cell phones might make a difference.
Yeah.
Something.
We have great communications on board. So, I think I heard just this past week, if anybody does Snapchat, I heard that they did the first Snapchat from the space station, just within the past week or so. If there's any listeners out there that saw that, maybe chime in and let us know what you thought or how it went. So,
all right, Sue's asking, when are they putting up the 20-meter delta loop? Of course, that's not going to work up there. The HF frequencies won't work from space, so there's not going to be any 20-meter delta loop up here, and let you guys hang clothes on it to dry. Now, hey, that brings another question. You have a washing machine? You have a washing machine up here? You wash clothes?
We don't, but we recycle all of our air.
That's right.
And all of our water. And we have a saying on board the space station, yesterday's coffee is tomorrow's coffee.
Yesterday's coffee.
We recycle everything on board the space station.
That is so cool. You know, I was talking to Owen Garriott a few years ago. Owen's a scientist, very
Skylab astronaut.
I said, Owen, I understand that they got this machine that takes your urine and makes it go back in a drinkable water. I said, how do you know when the machine goes bad? You know, it kind of is a joke, you know, and Owen was very serious. He said, oh, man, we got ways of testing that. We tested three different ways, three times before we, you know, so I guess you guys
every astronaut's nightmare.
yeah. If the water looks yellow, don't drink it,
yeah,
it's
probably,
bad probably,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, you know what they say about eating the yellow snow, you know, you kind of stay away from the yellow snow.
How long does it take to get your Earth legs back?
So there are some things that are surprisingly different when you come back. It's actually a lot easier to adjust to space than it is to readjust to gravity. We do have some balance things. You can see I'm wearing glasses. I wear glasses courtesy of my long-duration space flight. I had some vision changes.
And there's a question here about vision problems.
Yes. Yes, and I was one of the first ones that kind of, when I got back, I thought, I can't see very well. And we started this, which launched this study that some people for some reason. It might be diet, it might be genetic. Some people retain this intracranial, like increased intracranial pressure, and it kind of pushes on the back of the eyes and impairs your vision once you get back to Earth. And so that was kind of a new one on me, and I thought it wasn't like hugely alarming because NASA has helped me with it. And I was grounded for about 18 months to 2 years, and it took about 2 years and I was back on flight status. So my vision hasn't come all the way back, but I'm back correctable to 20/20 now. So if you see an astronaut with glasses, those are correctable to 20/20 if they're still active.
So is that affecting other astronauts, like the problem you
yes.
had?
Yes, there have been others. I've heard around somewhere between 20 and 25 astronauts have had similar type
did they know about
experiences
this
with their vision.
Before your problem?
They really didn't. Earlier flights they attributed to kind of a, maybe like sort of a short, something that lasts for a short period of time, or maybe even it was just the age of the, they kind of wrote off as maybe the age of the astronauts. But now, because we're thinking as we're flying longer and longer missions, and if we want to send really our kids and our grandkids to Mars, and they're going to be away from the Earth for 8 or 9 months getting there, and then 1 year on the surface of Mars, and then 8 or 9 months coming back, you want to be able to fully understand these physiological changes that the body goes through. So we're doing a lot of research now into vision and how we can use maybe exercise, maybe pharmaceuticals, maybe our changing things in the diet that can help us retain that little less intracranial pressure as we're flying in space.
KF7PCL says, I'm at college right now next to a classmate that's going into aerospace. She is very interested in your interview.
Well, hello there. What's it? Kilo.
KF7PLC.
Kilo Fox 7, Papa Charlie Lima.
Yeah.
Great to talk to you. Best of luck in the aerospace to your friend that's sitting there. And it's been a great ride for me. I've loved it. My undergraduate was in just general and applied science and engineering. And then my master's degree is in aerospace. It certainly isn't the only field where we have astronauts. In fact, there's a very, very, very narrow field in aerospace at the NASA, but we have electrical engineers, chemical engineers, mechanical engineers, and so any discipline in engineering and science is just huge for NASA. So come work for us.
Even plumbing.
Yeah, if you're a great plumber. And we fixed that solar array, Tom.
Yeah.
We actually had to.
Did you use duct tape?
We used duct tape. We used electrical tape, and we actually cut some sheet metal and made some cufflinks out of metal. And so, when I got back to Earth, I called my metal shop teacher in high school, and I said, everything I ever needed to know about flying in space and repairing the space station, I learned in my metal shop class in high school.
Are you telling me that right now, outside on the ISS, there's duct tape holding some solar panels on today?
It's not really duct tape, but it's similar to that. It's like we call it EVA tape.
I think I know what it is, Doug. I flew to Europe one time on one of our FedEx aircraft, and we had a hole get cut in the side by
a
food truck.
Over?
And they taped that up, and we flew on down to Brussels with the side taped up.
Well, you remember they refer to duct tape as 100-mile-an-hour tape. We used to call it in the Army 100-mile-an-hour tape. But up there, we need Mach 25 tape.
Mach 25 tape. So here's a question from PP2RON. I'm not sure where PP2 is. Somebody tell us on the chat room.
Okay, PP2.
It's an international call.
Awesome.
It may be somewhere in South America, or I don't know. But can you describe how re-entering the atmosphere aboard the Soyuz
is? Yes, wow.
And are there many spins?
So it's kind of a rough ride coming back in on that Soyuz, much different than in the space shuttle. I came home in the space shuttle in 2007, and that was a much different ride coming back in. Coming back in the Soyuz, it's very, very dynamic. First, you turn around, you fire this burn. And actually, it's just kind of a braking burn to kind of control your fall towards the Earth. And you look out the window, and you can sense yourself falling towards the Earth, and it can get kind of alarming. And then when you start hitting the top part of the atmosphere, the capsule will start this slow spin, So it kind of gives you a stable like a top, you know, so it starts spinning and starts burning back through the atmosphere. And the G-force is kind of through this axis, so you're kind of laying with your back towards the decelerative force coming back in. It gets up to about 6 Gs, and that lasts for several minutes, and then it kind of eases up back to about 2.5 Gs, and then it kind of digs in again back up to 6 Gs. That whole process is about 12, 13, 14 minutes of peak heating as you're burning back through. And when we landed, and the chute opens, it's kind of a hello, we're coming back, you know, and it's spinning and tumbling and things, and so your gyros inside are kind of tumbling, so you have to keep focused on the panel in front of you. And so when I got back, I was asked to describe the reentry and landing, and I thought, it's kind of like going over Niagara Falls in a barrel, and the barrel's on fire when you're coming back. Now, I've never been in a barrel going over Niagara Falls, but I imagine it's probably about like that, so.
Oh, man.
I saw a question on the tweet there. I'm going to send a tweet out here momentarily, but if you want to contact me on Twitter, it's Astro_Wheels. So Astro, A-S-T-R-O, underscore Wheels.
Is there an at sign in front of that?
At Astro underscore Wheels.
I don't use Twitter that much. But,
okay. Or you can use the hashtag AskNASA, and sometimes they'll relay those questions to me as well. If you have questions, you can send them to hashtag AskNASA.
All right, PB2RON is from Goiânia. I don't know that. Near Brasilia.
Oh, Brasilia. Okay.
Yeah.
Awesome. I took a really cool picture of Brasilia from the space station. Beautiful, beautiful city from space.
Mm-hmm.
I've never been there on the Earth, but hello to you in Brazil.
You have any WD-40 up there?
WD-40, you know, that's another thing we use. We don't have it on board the space station, but
they just don't want it up there.
The first thing you learn as an engineer, if it moves and it's not supposed to, you use duct tape.
Right.
If it doesn't move and it's supposed to, you use WD-40.
So, exactly.
But that's what we first learn when we get to NASA. We have lots of duct tape up there, but we don't have any WD-40.
So. Have you ever experienced any time that you would like to have had WD-40? Anything happen up here?
Gosh,
you know, rusting nut.
Sometimes things because of the heat, the heating and cooling cycles, especially if you're outside, it can be difficult to move a bolt or to break a bolt or something. The torque that's on a bolt. So, I had some difficult time when I first went on my first spacewalk, which was in October of 2007. My first task was to just, I had to undo like two bolts, like just like in a pit crew, like, and then I was done with that. And I just needed to pull it off. And it had 20 pounds of pull force, had like a little ball and socket soft dock. All I had to do is pull it off and hand it to my buddy. And then I was going to get in the robotic arm and he was going to hand it to me and we're going to fly it down. Well, I unbolted it, but it had been sitting there for 6 years. And you imagine that with the temperature changes and everything. And I took that thing and it was like cold welded on there. So I had to end up pounding on the same thing back in 2010. I had to pound on a connector to get it to loosen up. So
are there any Tang drink mixes? That stuff's still around? Tang? That was what the astronauts originally
We still have Tang. In fact, let me show you something here, Tom.
Yeah.
So we have to, when we go up to space, we can't call it Tang.
Oh, okay.
So we have to call it orange juice. And so it comes in a bag like this. I brought this from space with me as well. This is the Tang that I didn't get to when I was up there, but it's a powder inside of here. And of course, here we inject the bag with cold water. And
recycled urine,
basically. Like coffee from 2 days ago.
Yesterday's coffee.
So tomorrow's orange juice, yesterday's orange juice is tomorrow's orange juice as well.
Yeah.
So we can take this bag and fill it up with water, just kind of shake it up and rehydrate the powder that's in there. Now we stick a straw down inside of here. Let me see if I was just at a, with some school students, and so I don't know if they They let me keep my straw. Let me see if I still have it in here.
And you got a little piece of Velcro here where you can stick this to what, to your shirt or something? Or
I'll see if I can find that straw later. So, yeah, you see that all of our food
has
little blue dots on it. So if you imagine all your food is floating around in space, and so if you don't keep track of it, what we could do is we have lots of Velcro, of course, and we could just hook that onto our arm or leg. We have Velcro on our legs as well, and just kind of fly around with your dinner attached to you. You just kind of, you know, fly around the space station, and I'll take my turkey tetrazzini, and I could go and continue to do my work, and if I get hungry, I could just take my spoon and get a dish of my little spoonful of my dinner.
W3TLN asks if you speak Russian or English on the space station.
So the agreed upon language on the space station is English, and so everybody on board speaks English. But before I flew on the Soyuz spacecraft in 2010, I had to test out intermediate high in the Russian language aptitude. So I had to speak Russian. I wouldn't call it anywhere near fluent, but I had to be conversational, especially with. With the technical systems on board the spacecraft, so.
And I hear it's easy to say bad words or bad in Russian, right?
You have to be careful, just like any language that you're learning. Sometimes a direct translation, like a word-for-word translation into another language, doesn't work sometimes.
It doesn't work, yeah.
There are some colloquial things that occur in every language that if you do it as a direct translation, you can get yourself in a little bit of an embarrassing situation. I won't share those on the air, but when I get, if you ever catch me in a private conversation, ask me about those times where I embarrassed myself over in Russia.
Is there always someone awake on the IS? Do you have?
No, we actually.
You can all go to turn
we actually
time
all
to
go to sleep together. We do have people that are monitoring the systems on the ground. We have a lot of telemetry that's coming down from the space station to Mission Control in Houston and Mission Control in Moscow. Each control center can also send commands to the space station, so we can operate the space station from the ground as well while the crew is asleep.
All right, well, Doug, tell us a little bit right now what you're doing with NASA before you go back up in space. You're going to Russia?
Yeah, so on Tuesday, I'm going back to Russia, and we have all of our astronauts that are training to fly aboard the Soyuz capsule are living and training in Star City, Russia, which is a little east, about 40 kilometers east-northeast of Moscow. And so I'm going over there to be the director of operations for NASA in Star City.
So. Cool. What about static electricity? Does that exist up there?
Yes, it really does. We actually have, much like on the trailing edge of a wing of an airplane, you'll see like little static probes that come out that dissipate static buildup on charge that builds up. And even though we're in vacuum of space, we're still within the sort of the protective Van Allen belts of that surround the Earth. And so we do pick up. You can pick up an electrical charge on the space station, and so we have dissipators at the along the truss of the space station that kind of dissipate that electrical charge to space.
All right. Well, we've talked a long time. I think we're gonna cease this part of the interview.
Okay.
I'm sure there's other people that might want to say hello. You might even want to take a break and have a drink of water.
Okay. It's great being with you, and send me a question or a comment on Twitter. I'd be glad to take it and get to them. Again, it's @astro_wheels on Twitter, or send to #AskNASA, and I'll try to get to it that way as well. And we'll try to get all your questions answered.
Okay, well, very good. Thank you, Doug,
for talking
to our viewers
here. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah. Oh.